This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. John Lewis and the Challenge of Real Black Music. Christopher Coady. University of Michigan Press. Ann Arbor. Introduction. In February 1957, the pianist and composer John Lewis sat down with Nat Hentoff of Downbeat magazine to discuss, among other things, the public perception of Lewis music. This was not the first time Hentoff had taken an interest in Lewis and his group, the Modern Jazz Quartet, MJQ. He had already published two counterpoint columns between December 1953 and January 1954, charting the extent of Western art music influence on the MJQ's inaugural LP for the record label Prestige. In October 1954, he riffed on a similar theme about works performed by the group at a Birdland concert in New York. These public analyses of the group's engagement with Western art music tropes were undeniably supportive. Hentoff even went so far as to refer to the resultant music as the epitome of modern jazz, 1955b14. Yet by the time of the 1957 interview, suspicion had begun to creep into the journalist's tone. Lewis was asked to respond to criticism that the MJQ wasn't funky enough, that it had too limited a range of expression, and that it relied too much on fugal structures. A parallel line of questioning emerged about why Lewis preferred to remain entirely in jazz, the subtext being that his musical innovations seemed to indicate an inevitable genre shift. This part of the interview did not go particularly well. In Hentoff's words, Lewis was incredulous, shooting back, "This is where I have to be. I have no desire to be anyplace else. There has never been any question in my mind about it," 1957b15. The central mystery of this interview, and the focus of this book, is how we might reconcile such divergent interpretations of Lewis' musical trajectory. Indeed, from the very outset, Lewis' participation in the New York jazz scene was characterized by a unique approach to composition that seemed to denote, more often than not, the influence of Western art music. Replacing pianist Thelonious Monk in 1946, Lewis first gained prominence as a pianist and arranger for Dizzy Gillespie's big band. His through-composed work, Toccata for Trumpet, 1947, premiered by Gillespie at a 1947 Carnegie Hall concert, stood in stark contrast to the group's riff-driven Afro-Cuban numbers and signaled Lewis' arrival in the popular press as a man to be watched in the writing field, 11-1947-1. His following collaboration with the Miles Davis Nonet between 1949 and 1950 on what would eventually be termed the birth of the cool recordings in turn resulted in modal harmony and polyphony, applied to the group in a way that mimicked the conventions of French Impressionism, Vandeleur 2001-19. This outward-looking compositional style continued to drive many of the works Lewis would write for his own group, the MJQ, beginning in 1952. Within this collection, perhaps the most overt are the fugal pieces Vendôme, 1952, Concorde, 1955, and Versailles, 1957. Given such an apparent compositional bent, it is easy to understand why Hentoff might have asked a question or two regarding genre affiliation. Yet Lewis' response to Hentoff's query not only refutes the suggestion that Lewis may have been moving away from the jazz realm through the composition of these syncretic works, it appears to put forth the idea that even Lewis' most Western-sounding pieces have the potential to be read as genuine jazz products. The reader of the downbeat piece is then left to wonder, is there, in fact, a way of hearing the critiqued works as being grounded in the jazz tradition as Lewis suggests? Or do these works cross an essential sonic line in the sand, precluding them from a jazz-oriented analysis? To be clear, these are familiar questions in jazz discourse. Works from the diverse oeuvres of Duke Ellington, Miles Davis, and Charles Mingus, to name just the tip of the iceberg, have at one time or another been subject to criticism for straying too far from ingredients perceived as essential to the jazz sound. Yet through careful study of the historical worlds from which these works emerged, jazz scholars have come to an understanding of their syncretic nature in terms of a musical strategy aimed at keeping alive particular African-American musical tropes in an environment hostile to their presence. See Howland 2009, McGee 2007, Porter 2002. The cultural significance of Lewis music remains less certain. Certainly, there is a willingness in jazz discourse to view Lewis' works as part of the modern jazz movement of the 1950s. See, for example, Floyd 1995, Joyner 2000, Lopez 2002. Yet a spectrum of views persist regarding how we might best interpret Lewis' particular modernist bent. Is the fusion inherent in Lewis' approach, for instance, an attempt to resolve in jazz significant shortcomings in the eyes of the classical music community, Joyner 2080? Or might it better be understood as an approach aimed at rescuing jazz from the banality of the endless solo, Balliet 1971, 161? In turn, does Lewis' embrace of Western art music conventions work to assert jazz as a colorblind art, as Paul Lopez suggests, 2002, 255? Or does such fusion pose a musical, social, and cultural threat to real black music, as others have claimed, Floyd 1995, 167? This book aims to wrestle with and bring some measure of clarity to this spectrum of ideas by, for the first time, unpacking Lewis music through the lens of what Scott DeVoe refers to as moments of historical particularity, 1991, 553. Writing in the 1990s, DeVoe produced two groundbreaking works of scholarship that threw into question traditional methods of jazz analysis. The first of these, an article titled Constructing the Jazz Tradition, 1991, put forth the argument that the acceptance of jazz as art music in the United States between 1940 and 1950 was inextricably linked to perceptions of the music as being evolutionary in nature. Jazz scholars seeking to put forth a taxonomy of the genre's development then naturally did so in positivistic terms, aligning their work with the disciplinary norms of 1950s musicology. DeVoe believes that continued reliance on such a methodology forced oversimplifications and mythological constructs to develop in relation to the stories told about the emergence of different jazz styles. His book, The Birth of Bebop, published in 1997, set out to rectify this issue by providing a more nuanced and historically informed reading of one of these movements. Over the course of the work, DeVoe demonstrates that commonplace readings of bebop as a revolutionary musical response to the commercialization of swing music could be challenged by linking the economic and social pressures experienced by the movement's practitioners with the musical and professional decisions they made. By telling the story of bebop's emergence through an analysis of how musicians negotiated a morphing wartime and post-war music industry, DeVoe demonstrated that the revolutionary narrative of bebop's emergence was overstated, debunking one of the more powerful myths of the jazz canon. One goal of this book is to contextualize Lewis' work in a similar vein. To this end, it begins by detailing shifts in the jazz marketplace following the 1940s big band decline, and then surveys the ways in which New York and West Coast musicians recruited and initiated new patrons in order to maintain their livelihoods amid a changed professional landscape. One particular strategy utilized in this context was a compositional approach that managed to conjure European compositional conventions through the innovative deployment of what have traditionally been perceived to be African-American vernacular tropes. The clearest example of this double-voiced construct is the use of independent improvised counterpoint, a defining element of traditional New Orleans jazz, as a way of meeting the relevant polyphonic requirements of fugal episodes and expositions in Lewis' pieces Vendôme, Concord, and Versailles, although a plethora of additional compositional strategies similarly conceived can be identified both across Lewis' oeuvre and in the works of his contemporaries Miles Davis, Dave Brubeck, and Charles Mingus. Yet unpacking Lewis' engagement with Western art music constructs exclusively within an economic frame effectively circumvents dealing with some of the trickier aspects of Lewis' character. After all, this was a man who spoke fondly of his classical training as a child, MJQ Views 1987, 28, pursued a bachelor's degree from the Manhattan School of Music decades before the school had a jazz program, Lalo 1991, 22, often expressed a fascination with the Commedia dell'arte theatrical form, writing several pieces inspired by its characters, and, during the second half of his career, set about recording both Bach's Goldberg Variations and his well-tempered clavier. While such interests undoubtedly positioned Lewis on the edge of the jazz world, I argue in this book that they do not necessarily cast him beyond the parameters of real black music when one considers the wider African-American musical world. Through a survey of middle and upper-class African-American musical practices extending from the antebellum era through the 1950s, I demonstrate how, for many African-Americans, Western art music lay at the center of their musical lives. The musical works produced by this demographic, notably those of the spiritual arranger Robert Nathaniel Ditt and the symphonic composer William Grant Still, celebrate a history of African-American experience in the United States connected with folk practice yet simultaneously more expansive. The politics driving such engagement were undoubtedly rooted in an assimilationist goal. Yet in the minds of many middle and upper-class African-Americans during the 1940s and 1950s, they had clearly yielded something different, a particular conception of being African-American that overlapped but did not graft neatly onto identity constructs of the white hegemony. Reading Lewis' music in relation to this mindset enables a paradigm shift to occur in which we are able to understand its European sound in relation to a unique African-American experience linked strongly to social class. Still, even this approach can seem at times a little forced. Indeed, to approach Lewis' works as artifacts of a realized racial identity essentially prioritizes race over other contributing factors in the development of his unique aesthetic approach. In particular, focusing on racial identity issues crowds out discussion of developments in jazz thought that work to obliterate claims of musical authenticity grounded in racial ideas, paradigms that inevitably resulted in expanded parameters around what jazz could potentially sound like. Some of the more liberal of these philosophies developed overseas. In France following World War II, for example, skepticism towards dogmatic or purist cultural criticism very much defined the intellectual landscape, Jordan 2010, 236. But even in settings like post-war Germany, where African-American musical ability was still harshly stereotyped, the desire of local musicians to participate in the production of jazz led to an erosion of racial prerequisites and an expansion of musical approaches to the form. Indeed, the expansiveness of European-based jazz concepts after the war, coupled with an ongoing European fascination with American jazz musicians, seems to have paved the way for Lewis' positive reception on the continent. This reception, in turn, appears to have affected both Lewis' confidence in and his selection of artistic projects both at home and abroad during the late 1950s and early 1960s. These three ways of thinking about Lewis' music highlight for me both the usefulness and the challenge of answering DeVoe's call to examine jazz music within moments of historical particularity. Indeed, while such a methodology yields much useful data that informs our understanding of why Lewis may have composed the way he did, it fails to give us a definitive answer to the question of intent. If anything, the more one charts out the complexity of a historic moment, the harder it becomes to tell a story about that moment that might convincingly come across as complete and absolute. In other words, the more paradoxes or contradictions one reveals to a set of readers, the more difficult it becomes for both readers and author alike to settle on definitive meanings related to the use of particular musical tropes or compositional devices. From this viewpoint, my phrase, "the challenge of real black music," might be best understood as speaking to the difficulty involved in telling a story about an artist's involvement with something that many people experience as a very real thing, but conceive of differently. I have therefore focused mainly in this monograph on charting out how Lewis' works might have ticked the authenticity box for an array of different listeners, without attempting to distill any specific underlying truth about their musical pedigree. Yet at the same time, I do not shy away from the fact that I am most interested in undertaking arguments that challenge the idea that Lewis' music somehow evinced an abdication of African-American identity. Given all of the stories we could potentially tell about Lewis, it is particularly revealing to me that the dominant theme of his reception history, as I chart out in Chapter 2, is that of an abandonment of African-American culture. I believe such an understanding emerges from the persistent tendency of the trade press to decipher and write about African and African American music as inherently rhythmic, effusive, mystical, and naive. The analyses I provide throughout the second half of this book seek to break free from such discourse by offering new ways of thinking about what it might mean to produce music reflective of the African American experience once we've accepted that such an experience is in no way monolithic. Decoding the double-voiced, minstrel masks and signifying G. Although the central argument of this book is for a consideration of diversity within the African American cultural experience, there can be little doubt that parallels between Lewis' double-voiced approach and metatropes of African American artistic expression do exist. In particular, the playful reinvention of hegemonic conventions through the deployment of polyphonic improvisation that I describe in relation to Lewis' fugal works above can be linked in no uncertain terms to what many have considered a preeminent preservation strategy within African American culture, the masking of vernacular tropes. Houston Baker's Blues, Ideology and Afro-American Literature, 1984, and Modernism and the Harlem Renaissance, 1987, detail similar practices in the literary and discursive realms, documenting how African-American spokesmen of the late 19th century appropriated rhetorical devices from outside the African-American cultural set as a means of preserving the African-American voice in an environment hostile to African-American progress. Perhaps the most well-known figure of Baker's modernism study is the somewhat controversial educator and civil rights champion Booker T. Washington, a man whose life work is often summed up as equal parts racial advancement, most visible in his involvement with the Tuskegee Institute and accommodation to white interests, evident in his Atlanta Exposition or Atlanta Compromise speech and the self-deprecatory tone of his autobiography Up from Slavery, 1901-2010. Baker's analysis of Washington's autobiography, however, argues for a different conception of its supposedly accommodationist tone. Engaging rather than pushing to the side the plethora of African-American stereotypes present in the work, Baker demonstrates how the offensive serves as a veil or minstrel mask through which more radical agendas could be subversively articulated to a resistant audience. Such stereotypes are not difficult to find in the work. Baker points, for example, to Washington's story about how his mother stole chickens as a slave, and to Washington's admission of the difficulties involved in explaining to a heathen people the benefits of education, 1987, 27-28, conceptions of African-American morality and intelligence not uncommon in the target audience for Washington's work. Yet Baker views the intent of these stories as going beyond increasing the mere commercial palpability of Washington's autobiography in white circles. He views their inclusion as a necessary framing device through which Washington is able to articulate conceptions of African-American identity unfamiliar to the white hegemony. By beginning with stereotypes, but then telling a story of advancement that frames white paternalism as a central gear in the mechanics of racial uplift, Washington is able to make something potentially threatening to white audiences, the intellectual and political empowerment associated with the Tuskegee Institute, for instance, into something unthreatening and apparently organic within the ideology of white supremacy, Baker 1987-33. In other words, Baker endeavors to show that Washington and others adopted a conscious rhetorical approach in which they were ostensibly able to say two things at once about African-American identity. The findings of Baker's study can be seen to have had a dramatic impact on the development of both African-American literary and African-American musical theory in the following years. In particular, Baker's findings form the foundation of Henry Louis Gates's 1988 theory of African-American literary criticism and his promotion of the signifying G rhetorical trope as a primary lens for reading African-American cultural production. Signifying G, in Gates's study, refers to a mode of vernacular discourse long acknowledged by African-American sociologists and linguists in which multiple semantic relationships emerge through the playful deployment of seemingly unrelated terms, 1988, 49-52. Simply put, as with Baker's theory, it is the act of saying one thing and meaning another, usually in a humorous way. And while many have pointed out that such semantic play is not unique to African-American discourse, Myers 1990, Fenstermaker 2008, Gates 1988-21 does convincingly demonstrate its dominant function in the myths and storytelling of the African diaspora. As a result, both Baker and Gates were used as central theorists throughout the early 1990s in a body of cross-disciplinary scholarship aimed at illuminating syncretic strategies employed to political and social ends across the spectrum of African-American expressive culture. Murphy 1990, Tomlinson 1991, Brackett 1992, Walzer 1993, Floyd 1995. In the musical realm, this masking principle proved particularly influential in the reassessment of dismissed syncretic works produced by African-American artists. Indeed, it forms the primary analytical lens of Samuel Floyd's The Power of Black Music, 1995, in which African-American orchestral composers such as William Grant Still and Robert Nathaniel Ditt are rehabilitated as genuine crafters of African-American cultural products through the revelation of their double-voiced strategies. This approach, according to Floyd, imbued works with the semantic value of both African-American and European musical traditions, but realized a more Afrocentric political aim in its expansion of the African-American voice into nominally white spaces, such as the Concert Hall, 1995-110. In recent years, similar applications of the Baker-Gates paradigm have taken on new life in the analysis of symphonic pieces written by Duke Ellington, Burroughs 2007, Howland 2009, and assessments of the disparate oeuvre of Miles Davis, McGee 2007. These studies demonstrate how compositional elements, once viewed as working against vernacular elements in jazz, can alternatively be understood as providing a platform for their promotion. Within this set of analyses, the accounts of George Burroughs and John Howland prove most convincing, as they take the additional step of detailing the historically specific social and economic pressures that led to the use of a masking approach in Ellington's pieces. In both investigations, attitudes regarding the social value of jazz are shown to have stymied broad promotion of the music, and Ellington's symphonic approach is framed as an initiative aimed at winning over a reluctant demographic. In the view of Burroughs and Howland, the strength of the Ellington enterprise across diverse quarters of the music industry during the 1940s and 1950s stands in part as a testament to the effectiveness of this strategy. Given this current state of play, a signifying G or masking analysis of John Lewis music certainly seems overdue. The MJQ recording of the La Ronde Suite in 1955, for instance, shouts out to Europe in its title and multi-movement structure. Contrapuntal interplay, drawing heavily on the composed theme, weaves a thread through each individual movement, and Lewis' planing of coloristic chords at the end of the first is hard to read as anything but a direct reference to French Impressionism. Yet these movements are simultaneously filled with improvisation, each serving as a showcase for a particular instrument in the quartet. In turn, the content of these improvisations is unambiguously bluesy. They are chock-full of pendular thirds, flat sevenths, and flat fifths, and each movement contains an open passage based on a 12-bar blues form. When we then shift our focus from the sonorities of the work to its historic context, we can in turn see a set of circumstances that seem to confirm the political aims of the masking approach. Specifically, the work was recorded while Lewis was embarking on a quest to find new venues and new audiences for his music. He had formed the Modern Jazz Society in New York in 1955 and had actively reached out to patrons of modern music by including in his first program Luigi Nono's Polifonica Monodia Ritmica. Lewis was also poised to bring the MJQ to Europe for the first time, a successful economic endeavor that many have made sense of in terms of the fusion of musical aesthetics outlined above. Baker's masking concept helps us read this interplay of context and sound within a jazz rather than a classical music framework. In other words, instead of seeing a work like the La Ronde Suite as evidence of Lewis stepping toward Western art music, we can conceive of it as operating in the interest of jazz by opening up new markets and providing a pathway toward jazz appreciation for new consumers. It might even be seen in this light as a didactic work, in that it teaches appreciation for jazz by aligning contrapuntal and formal concepts from two different musical cultures. Such an understanding appears to reconcile the paradox of Lewis orientation outlined in the opening pages of this book, while carving out a space for it in the body of real black music. Heritage, class, and the idea of the Negro gentleman. Or not. Certainly this would have been an easier book to write if all of John Lewis' syncretic works could be explained away in such terms, if his work could somehow be reconceptualized in toto under the banners of Signifying G, or the Minstrel Mask. Yet the way Western art music tends to be valued in double-voiced analyses, as a vehicle suitable for the delivery of vernacular tropes only, does not seem to fit with what we know about Lewis' interests in and appreciation of the European cultural products that I described earlier. Many have interpreted such interests as indicative of what jazz critic Bill Koss referred to as a sociological trend during the 1950s, 1956-50. Believers in this trend saw African-American involvement with what were traditionally held to be European cultural forms as a purposeful assimilation project, in which participants moved away from their folk roots and into a sort of amorphous white American cultural milieu. The terms Black Bourgeoisie, Fraser 1957, and Black Anglo-Saxons, Hare 1965, were introduced during this period by sociologists E. Franklin Fraser and Nathan Hare as a way of encapsulating the economic, political, and identity issues tied up in what they viewed as increasing mimicry of white society among African Americans. Yet others, particularly those driving commentary in the African-American newspapers, the Chicago Defender and the New York Age, held an opposing view on the nature of what appeared to Fraser and Hare as blatant cultural abandonment. In the eyes of this group, the phenomenon of the Black bourgeoisie was evidence not of a rejection, but of a recommitment to African-American values. As the editors of the New York Age put it, it demonstrated the resilient heritage of what they termed the Negro gentleman. These two leave 1953-10. Unsurprisingly, when it came to assessments of Lewis' interests in European cultural products, the idea that Lewis was actively abandoning his cultural heritage failed to hold water with members of this camp, and it was in their publications that he was loudly applauded for taking jazz out of the type category and setting it into international orbiting. Pulley 1960, A17. One way we can understand how such different views about the possibilities or limits of African-American identity could emerge so forcefully in the 1950s is to break down the notion that the social experience of African-Americans throughout the history of the United States has been somehow entirely uniform. In many ways, despite its combative tone, the first half of Fraser's The Black Bourgeoisie provides us the tools to start such a project in that it details what at the time was a largely under-researched topic in American history, the cultural legacy of wealthy African-American families. Fraser notes that many in this elite class could trace their lineage to African-Americans who were free before the Civil War, or those who had enjoyed the advantages of having served in the houses of their masters, and places this group's assimilation of traditions practiced by the slaveholding aristocracy front and center in discussions of how members of the elite maintained their, albeit limited, political power, 1957, 112-14. Fraser loosely defines these traditions as the celebration of European literature and music, affiliation with the Episcopal, Congregational, Presbyterian, and Catholic churches, the use of a particular set of social codes, what Fraser calls manners, and the valuation of a professional education, 1957, 113-15. Yet while Fraser notes that economic and political integration correlated to some degree with the co-optation of these practices, he points out that social integration remained perpetually elusive for the African-American elite. Such a state of affairs had the ironic result of causing the African-American aristocracy, as Fraser sometimes refers to it, to become an increasingly insulated social group, cordoned off from both lower-class African-Americans as well as from the wealthy white classes whose traditions they had borrowed, 1957, 113-14. This isolation allowed the adopted traditions of the slaveholding aristocracy to take on new meaning for many in the elite class and for those who would later aspire to its ranks via education and the accumulation of capital. Devarian Baldwin's work on the Great Migration in Chicago is particularly enlightening in this regard. He describes the manner in which values linked to Fraser's genteel tradition, such as temperance, bodily restraint, and functional modesty in dress, coalesced into an ideology of African-American identity held by upper-class African-Americans during the 1920s. Initially, those who promoted this identity publicly did so as a way of presenting a unified and positive public image of the African-American race in order to counteract the cultural assumptions of white supremacy, Baldwin 2007-29. In her study of women activists in the Black Baptist Church at the turn of the century, Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham points to a similar phenomenon and coins the term the politics of respectability as a way of explaining the pursuit of racial uplift via the adoption of hegemonic behavior, 1993-188. As the mouthpiece of the African-American elite, urban African-American newspapers in turn frequently endorsed such respectability politics by making comparisons between the white world and the accomplishments of the African-American world as a way of demonstrating the facts of racial equality. Yet these comparisons were almost always caged in the language of competing spheres. In other words, even though the sort of cultural development prized by the African-American elite ran a parallel course to what they viewed as white cultural development, the reality of segregation made it difficult for those thinking about these issues to discuss them in unified terms. Thus, the framing of African-American genteel behavior as a cultural project separate from other cultural changes occurring in the United States allowed it to garner the weight of a bona fide African-American tradition, a concept frequently articulated in the pages of the African-American press during the 1940s and 1950s. Publications such as the Chicago Defender, the New York Age, the Pittsburgh Courier, and the Cleveland Gazette, among other African-American newspapers, routinely presented features and editorials that either implicitly or explicitly lay claim to refinement, artistic sensibility, Christian morality, and education as part of what they viewed as an African-American cultural legacy. As consumerism and liberalism in turn became increasingly part of the ether of white middle-class America, a societal change charted deftly in Elizabeth Fortarigo's Playboy and The Making of the Good Life in Modern America, 2009, these media outlets used this legacy to articulate what they saw as a growing rift between the values of Afro-America and the American cultural mainstream. Therefore, from the perspective of the African-American elite, the oft-cited formal behavior and dress of the Modern Jazz Quartet, along with the group's apparent interest in Western art music, did not signal, as it did to Koss, 1956, a move away from African-American culture. To the contrary, it appeared to be the realization of a long-awaited style of jazz that could effectively showcase folk elements while simultaneously rejecting liberal values of rebelliousness and emotional abandonment. Modern Jazz Quartet Top Unit, 1963-29. The tools Lewis used to craft such a product, his deployment of what one journalist at the Chicago Defender referred to as lapidarian construction techniques, but what might more simply be referred to as an emphasis on pre-planning and composition, did not wipe out jazz's inspiration and spontaneity. It simply disciplined and directed it. Modern Jazz Quartet Top Unit, 1963-29. The point here is merely to highlight the fact that although critics in the African-American press were not necessarily reporting on the music of the group in terms different from those used in publications like the New York Times or the trade magazines Downbeat and Metronome, the terms themselves carry different meanings depending on the orientation of the press within which they appeared. When the cultural frame of the Negro gentleman is used to read the works of John Lewis, Lewis' embrace of Western art music conventions can be seen to take on a decidedly different tone. To return to the example of the La Ronde Suite, nods to French Impressionism mentioned earlier need not be understood in this alternate paradigm as some sort of marketing trick, or at least not solely in those terms. They can also be read as celebrating a specific type of conservative musicality, stemming from one particular conception of African-American identity. Lewis' upbringing in a middle-class New Mexico suburb, Lalo 1991-9, his pursuit of a degree in music theory, and his general interest in European cultural products certainly helps us place him in this world. But we can make an even stronger claim to affinity with the bourgeois mindset by considering Lewis' comments about strengthening jazz with structure, Hentoff 1953A8, alongside his diatribes against those who would assume jazz necessarily correlates with bad behavior, Hentoff 1957B16. Reading Lewis' music through this lens is no less political than a signifying G assessment, but it does accomplish a different sort of cultural work, to use Guthrie Ramsey's 2001 phrase, by keeping the door open in the field of jazz studies for all sorts of sonorities that might be considered traditional in assessments of African-American cultural presence. Lewis and the European encounter. Yet examining class-based ideological differences between African-American communities is not the only way we can chart out an increasingly expansive view during the 1950s related to what jazz might sound like. In the U.S. context, acceptance of increasingly modernist jazz products aligned neatly with rising interest in jazz from the university sector, and the publication of a range of musicological texts that celebrated the pursuit of new sonic frontiers, including George Russell's Leidian chromatic concept of tonal organization, 1953-1959, and André Hodier's Jazz, Its Evolution and Essence, 1956. Lewis' directorship of the Lenox School of Jazz from 1957 to 1960 in turn oversaw the recruitment of jazz pedagogues with decidedly modernist mindsets, such as Russell, Lenny Tristano, Bill Russo, and Jimmy Giuffre, and the endorsement of a jazz curriculum aimed at pushing the limits of existing musical boundaries. Yet Lewis' confidence that this approach was, in fact, the right approach to teaching students new to the industry seems at odds with the MJQ's frustrating early tours of jazz clubs in the United States, detailed in Chapter 1 of this book, tours in which audience indifference occasionally forced the group to abandon the stage. Indeed, as I will show, such confidence seems to have instead arisen out of Lewis' experiences in Europe during the mid-1950s and his exposure to markets in both France and Germany that enthusiastically embraced syncretic jazz forms and boundary-pushing jazz works. In considering the French context first, it is important to note that an expansive view regarding the sonic possibilities of jazz music very much defined the French encounter with the genre even before the existentialist turn that followed World War II. There is, of course, no denying the fact that extensions of the noble savage Enlightenment motif, specifically the idea that unique musical ability resided in the biology of African descendants, typified French jazz critiques during the interwar period, Jackson 2002, 154. Yet at the same time, it needs to be understood that alternate and more pluralistic understandings of how one might authentically contribute to the form were almost always simultaneously in play. For instance, Matthew Jordan details how several interwar French jazz critics pointed to the music's origin in New Orleans, a city with deep French cultural ties, as a way of arguing that the French had just as much right to claim ownership of the new musical genre as those who were viewed as stewarding its African components, 2011, 512-14. The success of groups like the piano duo Wiener and Doucet during the 1920s and Ray Ventura et S's Collisions during the 1930s inextricably linked with this conception of an authentic French jazz grounded in the audibility of nationalistic tropes. Wiener and Doucet, for instance, were applauded for tapping into what was seen as jazz's roots in the French romantic song tradition, Delage 1926-19, while Ray Ventura was heralded for jazzing up French folk songs, Jackson 2002-160. Most discussion of post-war jazz in France has focused on the debate between those who endorsed pluralistic concepts of jazz practice, of which the nationalist school was just one version, and the leaders of the New Orleans revivalist movement, famously headed by the French jazz critic Hugh Panassier, Jackson 2002, Perchaud 2011. Yet focusing on this debate, in my mind, carries with it the potential to obscure the extent to which French audiences welcomed and, in fact, expected to encounter sonic shifts in the jazz world. Such an orientation is evident in even just a cursory look at Louis' reception in France during the 1950s. Indeed, while to many American critics, Louis' style of composition signaled movement toward a new musical genre, or the formation of what Gunther Schuller referred to as a third stream of music, Schuller 1986-120, French critics outside the influence of Panassier weren't so sure that the parameters of jazz had been breached. Following the MJQ's first tour of Europe in 1956, with the Birdland All-Stars, the Parisian publication Jazz Magazine came out in full support of the music audiences had heard, stating, "Ultimately, these concerts marked an important victory for the modern sound in our country, and French fans could see firsthand that jazz has never been better." Sous le signe du Birdland, 1956-19. In the same year, the English translation of André Hodier's Jazz, Its Evolution and Essence was published, including an expanded section on the state of jazz at the death of Charlie Parker, Hodier 1956a, in which Hodier applauded Louis' innovations for pointing the way forward to a music that had lost its way. Hodier writes of Louis, "He deserves unreserved praise for having faced up to the problem of the relationship between theme, arrangement, and solo, which is the most critical and the most formidable problem the modern jazz man has to solve. In fact, it may be the problem on which the whole future of jazz depends." 1956a, 278. Such resistance to purist jazz ideology seems to have in turn enabled greater interdisciplinary use of Louis music across the French cultural landscape. The French filmmaker Roger Vadim, for instance, boldly approached Louis in 1957 with the idea that he provide a score for Vadim's 1957 noir film Sait en Jazz, 1957. While the use of a jazz score in film noir was not without precedent, see Butler 2002, Vadim's offer did mark Louis' first encounter with the form and resulted in an incredibly innovative musical track in which improvisation was used to explore a variety of narrative themes. Furthermore, it was in Paris in 1960 that Louis began his dalliance with writing for ballet, collaborating with choreographer Louis Johnson on a work that saw dancers improvise in counterpoint to improvised music played by the MJQ, Precious Asset 1969. It is difficult to avoid comparing these projects with their American counterparts. Louis' score to the Robert Wise film Odds Against Tomorrow, released in 1959, and his score for the ballet Original Sin, performed by the San Francisco Ballet Company in 1961. Indeed, as I explore in depth in Chapter 4, acceptance of Louis' innovative vision within the French context seems to have encouraged Louis' pursuit of similar projects in works later performed on American soil. Yet it was not only Louis' time in France that seems to have encouraged commitment to his modernist project. Louis' encounter with the German jazz scene, in turn, can be seen to have endorsed aspects of his compositional style that had met less friendly reception in the American sphere. Unlike in France, post-war attitudes toward jazz in Germany remained firmly grounded in myths about African-American primitivism and intellectual inferiority. Hurley 2009-20. The majority of jazz assessments that did occur in print, at least those written immediately after the war, tended to be negative and to depict the music as a continued threat to German society, evincing, as Andrew Hurley has put it, an ideological hangover from National Socialist anti-jazz indoctrination, 2009-20. German jazz advocates in the post-war period were therefore required to find ways of challenging this ideology covertly, in that their primary aim was to convert, not alienate, the German public. Jazz critic Joachim Ernst Behrendt deserves credit for leading this assault, pursuing both musical and written projects bent on illuminating for the German populace ways in which jazz could be compared favorably to Ernste Musik, serious music, Hurley 2009, 24-25. In particular, Behrendt was interested in promoting the idea that Altmusik, early music, shared an affinity with jazz that could not be denied. Toward this end, he instigated a lecture tour in 1956, involving the music historian Joseph Troller and a jazz combo lead by Wolfgang Loth, a tour that involved the discussion.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.